Hello, and welcome to Swell Season Surf Radio. I am your co-host, Tyler Brewer, and welcome to another art and design series with Chris and Chris. I'm joined by contributors Chris Coffin and Christopher Labsa for their in-depth conversations with artists and creatives about their art, their processes, and how surfing relates to their outlook in the creative world. On this episode, they got a doozy. I mean, they got freaking like Thomas Campbell to come on the show. For those of you who may not be familiar, Timo, as he sometimes goes by, he is a phenomenal artist out of the Beautiful Losers generation. Did art in New York in the 80s and 90s, you know, influenced surf and skate culture, covered and documented it, then also made some phenomenal surf films like The Seedling, Sprout, and The Present, plus numerous influences in the surf world and influencing lots of surfers like Al Nost and, you know, to Dan Malloy, like crazy how much influence he's had. And seems like a really interesting, smart, articulate guy who, you know, is kind of going into the middle part of his career in some ways. And, you know, I'm fucking can't believe you guys got this on. So Chris and Chris, welcome to the show. And how cool is that?
Yeah, Thomas is fantastic. I'm so happy Thomas agreed to do this. He has been influential to a number of the artists we've already interviewed, actually, and like some coming up in the next couple of months. And his, personally for me, like I remember seeing Thomas at the Alleged Gallery in New York before things kicked off, and I was skating the Brooklyn Banks, and I was like, wow, like this is where art comes from. This is how this thing can actually be done. And for me, it was a kicking off point to actually see a path where I could have a creative path. And I think that's across the board for a generation, from Dan Collin to Jay Nelson, a bunch of other people. So it's been amazing. Yeah. Be able to interview him and see like where he's gone and where he sees his practice going in the future. Chris?
Yeah, it's Mr. Coffin, were you as familiar with him? Because I remember, you know, Mr. Labsa here was saying, like, how, you know, let's get Thomas here. Like, oh, I'm not as familiar. So, you know, you were, I want to hear, like, how you're what you found studying him and then what you found revealing in the conversation you had.
Well, I was more familiar with his contemporaries, like Barry McGee and the Beautiful Losers, and but when I got into studying his work and looking at the arc of his work, what really stood out to me was some of the more oddities that he's creating right now. I was really interested in talking with him about his newfound ceramic works, which most people probably wouldn't know much about. And I think I really like struck a chord with him because those ceramic pieces that he's working on or had just been working on at a residency that he was at were very politically charged. And part of the interesting part of our conversation was about these memories that he had while being a little boy and sitting in church and being bored to tears and actually looking up at these images of saints that were like behind the altar. And he said that those images stuck in his head and were now kind of like the jumping off point for making these ceramic pieces that he's like tying into the political climate of like what's going on right now. And I was like so intrigued by that, because when you look at his work and what he's known for, these ceramic pieces are so outside the box. They're like over here. But he was talking a lot about just about the momentum of creativity. And he's saying basically, you know, like life is art. This is what I do. And everything that I look at and everything that I touch and everything that I make is part of my creative thought. And this is what I'm thinking about now. So I really enjoyed that component. I like kind of like delving into the thing that was a little bit like left of center when you think about what his work is about.
And when you look at his politics right now, like he's very outspoken, you can understand where those pieces came from even more.
Right, for sure.
Yeah, no, I love, like, I mean, I see a lot of his stuff online and he's, he seems really committed and, you know, committed, you know, kind of Bernie supporter as well. I think it's real interesting, and seeing that kind of influence his artwork too. There's a lot of his work, especially 2000s, late 90s, 2000s, very surfy, dreamscapey, lots of pictures,
right,
moving images. To see it kind of take a turn is, I think, really interesting. And to get an interview with him at this point of his career, I think is amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, I think
a lot of his politics don't come to the forefront of what you see, but when you hear him speak about it, it makes absolute sense.
Yeah,
it does. It does. I mean, when you look at his work, of course, you're recognizing this like surf skate aesthetic, but there's a lot more under the surface when you start talking to him about what he's doing now, what he's thinking about now. I also like kind of like going back a little bit. Some of the things I enjoyed looking at and talking about with him were he did this kind of a phase of like bookmaking and zine making that very much kind of touched upon kind of like the music industry of the time and punk rock. And that kind of led to us talking about his interest in music now and being a music producer. It's all of these different interests that he has that is the sum of the parts that I was most interested in. Because when you look at an artist's work, you're like, oh, that guy's a painter, that guy's a sculptor, that guy's a furniture maker. You look at his work and you're like, wow, he does like a whole lot of interconnected things.
Yeah, no, he doesn't limit his medium at all, it seems. He can go, I mean, like you said, ceramics, but made some of the most iconic surf films, you know, of the last 20-30 years.
Oh God, Sprout, mm-hmm. Sprout changed my mind about looking at surfing, you know? I think he influenced a generation of shapers.
Shapers, Way We Ride, I mean, you know, everything from the editing style of his movies to, you know, like incorporating this certain, you know, the Mattson too, and like all these different kind of bands, like, and you know, just that kind of cool, chill, hipstery kind of music. Not that he's a hipster, but I'm just saying, like, it's definitely had a huge influence on surf culture, and he did a lot of art directing too for different surf brands too.
But the transition from like a Joel Tudor to an Alex Nost, and how that makes sense, was kind of cool.
You could draw the direct line from Joel to Alf with Thomas, you know. It's just like, you know, with the movies, like Seedling. And then
the success of both, I think. I don't know.
Yeah, well, you see, you know, I imagine, like, Al Nost, like, went on that trip to, you know, to the Indian Ocean there with Thomas and Sri Lanka. And, you know, what, he was, like, 17, I think, at the time. And so I imagine, like, that must have blown his mind, you know, 17, traveling with Thomas Campbell, Dan Malloy, like, surfing really sick waves on different boards and equipment. Like, that must have, like, you know, that's changing your trajectory of your career.
Which paved the way for, like, Craig Anderson and people like that.
Absolutely.
Awesome. So, I don't know, that's what I love, you know?
All right, I could go down a hole on that one, but... well, really excited for all our listeners. You're going to really enjoy this interview. So here we are with Thomas Campbell. We hope you enjoy. And this is, almost forgot one thing. What are you drinking right now, Chris?
Me?
Yeah.
Drinking Austin East Cider. The pineapple.
Pineapple? Ooh. Love some pineapple. Austin East Cider. That's delicious. That's like summer, Friday night. Really good. Put a little mezcal in it and you're set. they've been hooking us up with some free cider, so got to give a shout out to them and appreciate the love from where can they find it, by the way? Where can people buy it?
I'm not sure where they're located, but they could look up the website
austinestciders.com,
and for these, they're organic and amazing. There's like four ingredients. They're delicious and dry. And I love them.
And I love them.
And I love them.
And I love them. Nobody has paid him to say that. They just gave him free stuff, and it's now brought him so much joy. Well, all right. There's the commercial. And now we bring you Thomas Campbell. Thank you for your patience, and enjoy. You.
We're like an hour away, so we still maintain a lot of hard contacts there, and you know, do our thing. Yeah,
awesome.
So whenever I need to get in the water, I actually go in the opposite direction now. I head north up to Rhode Island, so I've been surfing like up in Rhode Island most of the time now.
Nice.
Yeah,
you're in your studios in Bonnie Doon, right?
I live at the same place where my studio is, so yeah, it's just like 10 miles up the coast north of Santa Cruz, and then like 3 miles up the hill.
Hey guys, this is my daughter Luna.
Hi Luna.
You ready, kiddo? Mommy's gonna put you to bed.
Go.
What's hanging out? Tuck that in. So yeah. So you live in your studio space, and you have your home there on the West Coast?
Oh no, I have a kind of like, I have a 3-car garage that's my studio, and then I live in the house near it. So
nice,
yeah, and it's like kind of in the woods and pretty tranquil place. I mean, I think if you came here, you'd be like, dang it. Like it's pretty good. It's pretty like, just energetically, it's really kind of like the vibes are extremely mellow. Yeah, it's good. I'm really, you know,
that's we should start. You were recording this, right, Chris?
We are recording now. Yeah.
You know, Tom, it's interesting. I you know, did some bio, you know, research, and like you and I are exactly the same age, and yeah, it seems like we both have kids and we have families, and we have I'm an artist also, and you know, we have a practice, and you know, getting out of like the metro center was I don't know how you feel, but like for my wife and I, she's an artist also, it was a little scary to like leave the hum of New York, or to leave the hum of a creative center, and then go find something that's a little more mellow, and learn how to still create minus that hum. You know, do you still have that? Do you have that experience?
Well, say like when I lived in New York, mm-hmm. My studio, like I lived on the Lower East Side mainly. Like I lived all over, but I lived like on Ludlow. Before Ludlow was something.
Yeah, yeah.
And my studio was in Dumbo. And my studio was an 800 square foot
studio, and I paid $150 for it.
Yeah.